The Sundown close-up. It was a storm that packed a punch that New Hampshire hasn't seen in quite a while. So what did the state do right, and what were the lessons learned? And while winter is here, the campaign trail, well, it's getting hot. We're going to hear from the state party chairs, just about a year now away from primary day. Morning, everyone. Thanks for joining us. I'm Josh McKelvin. No doubt about it, many of you are storm weary. I get it. And while the last thing you probably want to hear about or talk about is more snow. Well, the reality is, last week's snowstorm was historic, not only because of its size, but also because of how New Hampshire and its residents responded to it. Joining me to talk about it this morning and the challenges that still remain, the mayor of the hardest hit area of the state, Nashua Mayor Donnelly Lozo, and the director of Homeland Security in the Granite State, Perry Plummer. Welcome both. Thanks for being here. Yeah, so let's start with that. And Mr. Plummer, we'll start with you. Sure, this was a huge storm, and it dumped a bunch of snow. But in terms of public safety and communication, could things have gone any better?
Well, you always can do better, but certainly we think that it was very successful. The response from the local partners, from the state partners, was all very successful. And obviously, the pinnacle is the storm, but we do planning year-round. I know that they do in all the cities and all the towns do planning year-round to make a storm response successful. So we think we're pretty successful. There's always things we can do better. We'll look at it in after-action report and make sure that we fix anything that we can fix and always improve.
And I think Nashua was hit with, what, like 18 feet of snow or something?
Certainly felt like it. Right. 33 inches can be an awful lot of snow when you think about it.
Yeah, 33 inches.
That's the largest I think we have on record. Yeah. Certainly the largest we've had on my watch, and we've been through some interesting weather since I've been here in 2008.
How do you plan? Can you plan for that? I mean, Perry was talking about the planning for it, but when you talk about 33 inches.
Right. Well, actually, you can plan certain things that are important. I mean, Nashua is very fortunate to have a dedicated full-time emergency management director, the only one in the state besides the state director, and he works on things all year long. And one of the benefits of that is the coordination of different city departments and divisions working together. And so he called a meeting together, you know, we all sat down, made decisions from trash pickup to timing of the parking and what we're going to do about towing vehicles, you know, everything that we normally have. But we did a comprehensive response to it that we got out to everybody in the city about 3 o'clock in the afternoon. So that was all very helpful.
No question about it. People stayed off the roads and heeded that message, which was good. And we were happy to play a part in the media. One thing that struck me, though, I was told, Director Plummer, was that 911 calls, emergency calls, were actually down lower than they were on a normal day in New Hampshire. Which really means that people were listening and being careful. I mean, that's pretty amazing for a storm of that size.
There's no question about it, and quite frankly, that is where we kind of take a look at the activity, and that's our first indication of what's going on out there. As you know, the Emergency Operations Center and 911 Center are located in the same building. We walk right across the hall and say, what are you seeing? And they were down. Now, certainly people, you know, heard the words of the governor and stayed off the roads, and that was fantastic. But they also used common sense across the state during that period of time, too. And I think that, as the governor always puts it, that's Granite Staters. They used good common sense, and I think they did. With that being said, really, it helped the plow crews, and they did a fantastic job during this. Both state and local plow crews, you know, they're behind the scenes. You know, you see them go by your house and maybe you're upset because they plow into your driveway a little bit, but they work numerous hours and hours and hours without sleep, and they did a fantastic job during this. And, you know, I think that recognizing them is really important.
Yeah, no question. And in your city, your plow drivers, I mean.
We had, you know, 74 people out around the clock. I mean, a lot of them got past the 36-hour mark and were still there. We had cots on site for them to be able to take a couple of hours of a nap if they needed it. They were working well together. You know, I went in, talked to them. You know, they really work hard. They did a great job under really difficult circumstances.
I talked to you the night of the storm, I think when it was about to let up, and you said, well, right now at this point, we're trying to figure out where to put the snow.
Right.
You know, and more snow. Right. So, what are your options when it comes to that?
Well, you know, there's not a lot, and I don't think people necessarily realize. I mean, actually, one of the first text messages that I got the morning after the storm, while it was still snowing a bit, was, so how soon is the snow going to be removed from the downtown sidewalks? And I thought, you know, not anytime soon.
Right.
But you know, the school sidewalks, we had to get those open. We have, you know, at least three schools that have primarily walkers to school. So, you know, those were a priority. Our sidewalk plows had to get out. And, of course, the same people that are plowing your streets are also removing your trash and clearing the sidewalks. You know, all of those things, this is the same crew. And so having people realize that. And so now, of course, the next thing we want to do is try to remove as much as we can, particularly knocking down, you know, areas where there are not traffic lights at intersections where people have to poke out, you know, to try to see.
See around the corner
there. Right, and so we'll be doing some of that, hopefully, you know, cutting down those banks before what we know is coming on Friday. On Monday, we're actually a little bit more concerned about what's coming Sunday and Monday. So we're hoping to be prepared for it. And we have areas in the city where we usually put our snow. You know, we load it up into dump trucks and we bring it different places. So we've added a few new areas where we're going to be storing snow, mostly because it's closer to where we need to make that happen.
How's the budget?
Well, you know, we budget about $1.6 million for snow every year, right. And we have a snow trust fund that's over about $300,000, and we usually manage pretty well within those two things. But let me give you an idea. As the director, we were talking on our way in, they've sent out requests to, you know, our emergency management directors and other communities about what are your costs. So we don't have all the costs together yet, but I can tell you that when you look at the storm we had in 2013, Nemo, that was about $400,000 in cost just for that storm alone. Mm. And the window that we're looking at for reporting costs on this storm ended yesterday. So all the costs associated with the removal
yesterday
over the next few days.
Wednesday. This airs on Sunday.
Oh,
so
pardon
let's
me.
Keep it
So the numbers that we're looking at are from the start of the storm till Wednesday at 3 p.m.
Right.
So any of the things that happen between now and Friday for cleanup can't even be counted in those numbers.
So Director Plummer, what do we do? Obviously, the goal here is to try to get some federal help.
Yeah, so, you know, there's thresholds for presidential declarations, and there's really three criteria. First of all, there's a dollar value criteria. There's a statewide criteria, which is just over $1.8 million, and then there's a criteria for each county. So that's why you'll hear sometimes there's a presidential declaration for the state, but only for three or four counties, because they have to meet their financial requirements. On top of that, this is a snow event, so we have to have snow levels, and it's all based on records on record snows. It has to be within 10% of the record snows. So we've met that in some counties, in some areas. We think we're going to meet the financial threshold from local expenses and state expenses. And then the third criteria, which isn't as easily defined, is was it overwhelming for the resources of the state and locals? So we have to define that. I can tell you that you know, we hope that we can get a presidential declaration. We're long way away from knowing that. We're in the information gathering stage, but certainly all the financial indicators indicate that we're going to have those numbers to be able to at least qualify for one, and then the governor can request one from the president. So that's the expenses are for, you know, obviously preparation, you know, overtime, all additional expenses that occur.
So storm-related.
Storm-related additional expenses. So if someone is a normal day working, those expenses can't be recovered. It's their overtime and those types of things.
Let me ask you, sir, both of you actually can weigh in on this. When you have a situation which, I mean, it was a state of emergency. Clearly, this was a huge storm. But you're the director of Homeland Security. You're not just the director of Homeland Weather Security, and you're the mayor of a large city here in Nashua. Does something like this serve as a good model for any sort of event, whether it's an act of terror, God forbid, or anything along those lines?
Well, I think that, you know, the mayor mentioned earlier about, you know, I think maybe it was off the air, about ICS training, incident command training, unified command. All those command and decision makers are all in the same room, the EOC, either at the city level, local level, or our level. We bring all those partners together on a regular basis. So certainly an all-hazards model, which we all call it an all-hazards model, you do take some of those things away from this storm for other disasters or emergencies, for sure. So, yes, it's a learning process, and we want that similar type of approach so we can mitigate these as quickly as possible.
Sure.
Well, and getting the information out, you know, it's really critical. I mean, a lot of our staff has been trained in managing some of these things. It's management under crisis, because things are thrown at you constantly that, you don't expect. And so you train for those things. And yes, I think it's transferable to a lot of things. A lot of the work that our emergency management director does throughout the year includes things like going to private child care centers, working with the schools, working with nursing homes, working with the two hospitals, so that everybody's on the same page and everybody is getting their information from the same source. He does situation reports and has a list that that information goes out to. And the media, you guys were huge help for this because, you know, people are curious. They want to be outside. And you provided that window to the outside for them in multiple locations. And I think that helped them to feel okay about staying inside a little bit longer.
Well, trust me, some of the viewers were burnt out a little bit by the
snow. Oh, I'm sure they were.
You can't believe it. Question, though, is that, I mean, we'd like to call this the perfect storm, but as the director indicated, you know, there's things that we can work on. If there's one thing that you'd like to improve on, have you identified it yet?
You know, actually, we haven't had our after incident yet, but, you know, this storm actually was in you know, as best as you can describe it, a perfect storm, because we actually had the luxury of planning. Mm-hmm. I mean, that doesn't happen. So we came together during normal business hours, and we worked on laying out a plan. We executed it, you know, as planned. The storm came after the commute. I mean, you know, all of those things were really, really helpful in getting this done right.
Last word, Director Plummer, anything that you'd like to see done differently?
Yeah, or? Obviously, I think communications at all levels always can be improved. We're always looking at how do you communicate with the public better, how do you communicate with your local partners better, and how do we communicate with state partners better. You know, a good example is the last storm that we had large power outages. Power outages was a big deal,
right,
in the last storm, not this storm. And so we went out, we looked at our after action report, and there was some questions about communications from power companies to their first responders and trying to get real-time information. So this storm, we actually had someone from PSNH right in our emergency operations center, so if those questions come in, we could get the information out. So every storm you look at, you say, how do we make it better for the next storm or the next disaster? So in this case, power outages were not not a real issue, but certainly we always are looking at that to say, what can we do a little bit better?
Yeah, the power outage widespread certainly throw a giant monkey into the wrench, doesn't it?
Sure.
Right. All right. Well, job well done, and I appreciate you guys coming in. I know there's still a lot of cleanup to do, and I know you're still busy, so thanks for coming in.
2,200 hydrants, 8,000 catch basins. Job well done by the staff. Right. I think we're both proud of them.
Yeah. Congratulations. There's more coming from what I understand, so we'll see. And go Patriots, right?
Exactly. Right, exactly.